As you all know, due to the current lockdown, due to the global pandemic of COVID-19, the lectures, practicals were kept on hold. But now Prabhudha Institute of Medical Sciences is conducting an online lecture series. So today's lecture is for the subject microbiology. I welcome you all to the first e-lecture of microbiology, which is from the section virology, and the topic is HIV, that is human immunodeficiency viruses, and AIDS. So at the end of this lecture, students shall be able to learn morphology and etiopathogenicity of HIV, laboratory diagnosis of HIV infection, and treatment and post-exposure prophylaxis of HIV infection. So first of all, what is HIV? It is an abbreviation. Full name is human immunodeficiency virus, because it principally infects human beings and only few other animals, and it causes immunodeficiency. That means it targets the immune cells, and it is a virus. So full name is human immunodeficiency virus. As you all know, viruses are differentiated on the basis of their genetic material between DNA viruses and RNA viruses. So HIV virus is an RNA virus, and it is also an enveloped virus. The nucleocapsid is enveloped in a separate membrane that is called as envelope, and HIV belongs to the retroviridae family. So what is retroviridae family? That we shall see. So retroviruses are those viruses which possess a unique enzyme, reverse transcriptase, that directs the synthesis of DNA from the viral RNA after infection into a host cell. This is a little bit contradictory to the central dogma of life, which is the starting point is DNA and then RNA and then protein and further steps of cell replication. In case of retroviruses, the starting point is RNA instead of DNA. In the retroviridae family, there are two important genera: genus lentivirus, which contains human immunodeficiency virus type 1 and type 2, and genus delta retrovirus, which contains human T cell lymphotropic viruses. There are some other genera also, but all other genera are non-pathogenic to human beings. Hence, only two genera are important: delta retrovirus and lentivirus. Lentivirus containing HIV virus. Now, what is the importance of human immunodeficiency virus? HIV is the etiologic agent of acquired immunodeficiency syndrome, that is commonly called as AIDS, which is the biggest threat since last 3 decades. You may say that current COVID-19 threat is bigger than this. That may be true or may not be true, but still, we all should remember that even though COVID-19 is the current problem we are facing, we should not forget the other microorganisms which are problematic to human beings. HIV is one of them. So these are some historical points which are important in relation to AIDS or HIV. The first case of AIDS was described from New York in USA in 1981. The first culture or isolation in vitro of HIV-1 virus was done at Pasteur Institute, Paris in 1983. And HIV in humans is believed to be acquired from chimpanzees. Now, some aspects of morphological features of HIV. The shape of the virus is spherical, the diameter being 80 to 110 nanometer in size. Always remember, viruses are in size nanometer. Size range is nanometer, not micrometer, not at all millimeter. HIV is an enveloped virus, already discussed. The envelope is made up of lipid part, which is from the host cell membrane, and protein part, which is of viral origin. The protein part has two components, glycoprotein 120 and glycoprotein 41. This is the diagrammatic representation of HIV virus. You can see the nucleocapsid, that is genome, and the protein capsule are covered by a separate envelope. The nucleocapsid is icosahedral in symmetry, which encloses the genome of the virus. The genome is two identical copies of single-stranded positive sense linear RNA, and viral enzymes, which are reverse transcriptase, integrase, and protease. Now, HIV genes and antigens. In the HIV genes, there are two types of genes, structural genes and non-structural genes. Structural genes are of three types. First is GAG gene or GAG gene. Second is POL gene or POL gene. And third is ENV gene. The role of first gene, that is GAG gene, is to code for the core and shell proteins of the virus, which constitute P18 and P24. P24 is important in laboratory diagnosis of HIV infection. The second gene, POL gene, codes for the viral enzymes such as reverse transcriptase, protease, and integrase. These enzymes are important in replication of the virus. The third gene, ENV gene, codes for the envelope glycoprotein, which is cleaved into two components, GP120 and GP41. These protein molecules are important for the attachment of the HIV virus to the host cells. And in non-structural genes, there are many genes like TAT, NEF, REV. All these genes have some other roles, like in HIV replication, infectivity of the virus particles, or in releasing the progeny of viruses from the host cell, and some other minor functions. Now, related to these genes and antigens, why HIV/AIDS is a big problem? The problem lies in the HIV showing extensive antigenic diversity. Why this antigenic diversity? Because of the high rates of mutation. As you all know, mutations are fairly common in viral population, but HIV is going under mutations very frequently, and this is due to the error in the working function of reverse transcriptase enzyme. The most notably, mutations are seen in ENV gene, which codes for the envelope proteins, and these proteins are major target against which our immune system produces antibodies. Hence, if ENV gene undergoes mutation, the proteins of envelope are changed and the antibodies which were produced by our immune system are no longer effective. So this is how mutations in ENV gene is the main reason which explains how HIV evades the host's immune response, and this is the reason why vaccination against HIV is extremely difficult. Now, HIV serotyping. You should know that there are two different types of HIV virus in India, HIV1 and HIV2. The differentiation is based on the sequence of ENV gene. The HIV1 and HIV2 are then subdivided into distinct groups. HIV1 is divided into three groups, M, N, and O, and HIV2 is divided into eight groups, labeled as from A to H. In HIV1, M is the dominant group worldwide. Now, some information about the disinfection and inactivation of the virus, that is, how to get rid of this virus from your environment, from your hospitals, from your clinics, from your OPD, from your wards, from your operation theatres. So basically, because being an enveloped virus, HIV virus can be easily inactivated or destroyed by surface active agents. Some of the chemicals which are very effective in inactivating this virus are household bleach, which is a chlorine based compound, ethanol, isopropanol, alcohol based, Lysol, paraformaldehyde, hydrogen peroxide, and some other chemicals. And then differences in the temperature, like 56 degrees Celsius for 10 minutes or some other changes in the temperature. And extremes of pH, when pH is reduced drastically to 1, that is highly acidic pH, or increased to 13, that is highly alkaline pH. In highly alkaline and highly acidic pH, the virus doesn't survive. Now, how does HIV get transmitted? That is, routes of transmission or modes of transmission of HIV infection. So, if described in just three words, the routes of transmission of microorganisms can be said to be through ingestion, inhalation, and inoculation. HIV virus qualifies only one of these three categories. HIV does not get transmitted by ingestion, neither by inhalation. HIV gets transmitted only through inoculation. And which are the various routes of inoculation? These may be blood transfusion or parent to child transmission, that means from infected mother to the fetus in utero, through sexual intercourse or through injection drug abuse, or a subset of injection, that is needle stick exposure. So these are the various routes by which HIV can get transmitted, out of which you can see the majority contribution is by blood transfusion and parent to child transmission. The rest of the ways or rest of the modes of infection are very less important. But still, these are the percentage given worldwide. The percentage may vary country to country. The viral load is said to be maximum in blood, genital secretions, and CSF. It is variable or non-reliable in breast milk and saliva, and zero to minimal in other body fluids or urine. So risk of transmission of HIV from these other body fluids or urine is very minimal. The highest risk is from blood, genital secretion, and CSF. Now, pathogenesis, that is how after infection HIV starts replication or starts causing the disease. The main receptor that is responsible for the attachment is CD4 receptor on the host cell surface. The CD4 molecules are mainly expressed on helper T cells and some other cells of our immune system. Some co-receptors are also there, which play important part in attachment of the HIV virus. The names of the receptors are CXCR4, which are present on T lymphocytes again, and CCR5, which are present on macrophage cells. One more important receptor, DCSIGN, that is DC sign, which is present on dendritic cells. It may facilitate transport of HIV by dendritic cell to lymphoid organs, where HIV replicates further in T cells. After the attachment, the virus commonly undergoes the same replication cycle as other viruses. A main important difference is in the latency. The latency phase is slightly different in case of HIV virus, because it is able to replicate even in latent stage and is infectious to the neighboring cells also. Now, the disease progression. Disease progression, that is severity of the disease or degrees of the disease conditions, are affected by various factors, which can be subdivided into viral factor, host factor, and environmental factors, out of which viral factors and host factors are the molecular level details. Viral factors like viral fitness, co-receptor usage, generations of escape mutants, etc. Most easily understood can be the environmental factors, which include nutritive status of the recipient or the patient, and co-infections or opportunistic infections during the course of the infection or the AIDS disease. According to the clinical stage, HIV infection can be subdivided into five different stages, starting from acute HIV disease or acute retroviral syndrome. Second is asymptomatic stage. Third is persistent generalized lymphadenopathy. Fourth is AIDS related complex, and the last is AIDS. So the first stage, acute HIV disease or acute retroviral syndrome. Following the infection, following the attachment of the HIV virus to the T lymphocytes and the multiplication, HIV is carried to the lymph nodes and other lymphoid tissues, where further multiplication occurs in T cells. Initially, HIV destroys the infected T cells and spills over into bloodstream to cause primary viremia. This coincides with the initial flu-like illness that occurs in many patients 3 to 6 weeks after the primary infection. There is a significant drop in number of circulating CD4 T cells at this stage. The second stage is asymptomatic stage, also called as clinical latency, where adequate immune response develops within 1 month in most of the patients. Both cell mediated immunity and antibody mediated immunity, that is humoral immunity, play important part. Here viremia drops down and CD4 T cell count becomes normal, but immune response is not able to clear the infection completely. HIV infected cells persist in the lymph node and there is a high level of ongoing viral replication in this latent stage. This stage may last for 10 years, but the range is from few months to 30 years. Once the latency is broken, the disease progresses rapidly. Third stage is persistent generalized lymphadenopathy, or abbreviated as PGL. As a result of HIV replication in lymph nodes, 25 to 30% of infected people who are otherwise asymptomatic develop lymphadenopathy. This lymphadenopathy must be distinguished from other causes of lymphadenopathies such as lymphoma. Hence, in such conditions, lymphoma may be a differential diagnosis. Fourth stage is symptomatic HIV infection, also known as AIDS-related complex or ARC. The CD4 T cell level starts falling markedly and eventually patient develops constitutional symptoms such as unexplained diarrhea lasting for more than 1 month, weight loss, more than 10% of the body weight, fatigue, malaise and night sweat, and mild opportunistic infections such as oral thrush. You should be knowing what opportunistic infections are. And the last stage, AIDS, is the advanced end stage of HIV infection, which is characterized by rapid fall in CD4 T cell count, which is usually less than 200 cells per microliter, high viral load, lymphoid tissue is totally destroyed and replaced by fibrous tissue, opportunistic infections set in because of the destruction of the immune cells or the whole immune system, development of neoplasia, different type of malignancies develop, one of the examples is CNS lymphoma, and development of direct HIV induced manifestations such as HIV encephalopathy. So AIDS is actually the final stage, end stage of the HIV infection. It is not necessary that when a person is infected with HIV, the stage of the disease is AIDS. AIDS is actually the final stage, end stage of the infection. The world authorities like WHO and CDC have given different classifications of HIV infection. These are based on the clinical stages, which you can see later on. Now the epidemiology, global situation of the HIV infections all over the world. Since the discovery, 78 million people have been infected and 39 million deaths have occurred due to HIV worldwide. In single year 2016, 1.8 million new HIV infections occurred globally with 1 million deaths. And at the end of 2016, about 36 million people were living with HIV, including 1.8 million children. All over the globe, sub-Saharan Africa remains the most severely affected part. Now the HIV situation or AIDS situation in India, the statistics is by the end of 2017. By the end of year 2017, the adult HIV prevalence in India was reported as 0.22%, 0.25% in males and 0.19% in females. Number of PLHA, that is people living with HIV or AIDS, were over 21.4 lakhs. The maximum number of patients being in Maharashtra, followed by Andhra Pradesh and Karnataka. The reservoirs, who are the sources of the infections? The sole source of the infection are the infected people. which may be both symptomatic as well as asymptomatic. Both are the source of infection. They harbor the virus for life. The high-risk groups which commonly acquire the infection are homosexuals and people with multiple sex partners and prostitutes, healthcare workers which get the infection via accidental needle pricks or blood splashes on the eyes or other mucosal surfaces, intravenous drug addicts, hemophiliacs and other recipients of blood or blood products. So patients who get repeated blood transfusions are at more risk of getting the HIV infection. And lastly, people with other sexually transmitted diseases, they are more prone to get the HIV infection. One more important epidemiological aspect is opportunistic infection. Globally, including India, TB or tuberculosis is the most common opportunistic infection that occurs in HIV infected people. As you already know, this virus causes the immunodeficiency. As the immunity is down, many bacteria, many other viruses and many fungi and even parasites get a chance, get an opportunity to harbor inside human body and cause diseases. Some of the examples of such opportunistic infections are categorized as fungal, commonly candidiasis and pneumocystis jirovecii. In viral infections, commonly herpes simplex and cytomegalovirus. And in parasitic infections, commonly cryptosporidium parvum and toxoplasma. All over the world and even in India, there are some regulatory authorities or organizations which give us the guideline for diagnosis and treatment and containment of the HIV infection. At the international level, UNAIDS is the name of the organization, which is the Joint United Nations Program on HIV and AIDS. In India, at the national level, the organization working on HIV/AIDS is NACO, that is National AIDS Control Organization. And in India, in all the states, the state level organization working on AIDS is State AIDS Prevention and Control Societies. These organizations give us the guideline for diagnosis and treatment and containment of the HIV infection. Now, kinetics of immune response. How our immune system tries to deal with this viral infection. All the types, IgM and IgG and IgA types of antibodies are developed, among which only IgG immune response is consistent and long lasting. Most currently available assays or laboratory diagnostic tests detect these IgG antibodies. IgM immune response appears earlier than IgG, but sensitivity is low and is detectable for a very short period. It is valuable for identifying early seroconversion and particularly following needle stick injury and infection in newborn. Detection of IgA is useful in seromucus secretion and in newborn. Now, the important part, laboratory diagnosis of HIV infection. Related to the laboratory diagnosis, a number of moral, ethical, legal and psychosocial issues are associated with a positive HIV status. Following care should be taken while performing the test for HIV. These are labeled as 3 C's. First C is consent, which should be taken in a written format before the test is done. Second C is confidentiality of a positive test result. And third is counseling. Whenever the test result becomes positive, counseling should be provided to the patient to motivate to tell the spouse or family and induce behavioral changes so that the patient's immunity will be maintained and the infection will be contained. Now, the various tests available for the diagnosis of HIV infections can be categorized into two major categories, specific tests and non-specific tests. These are the specific tests available for diagnosing HIV infection: screening tests, supplementary tests and confirmatory tests, out of which screening test and supplemental test detect the antibodies in the patient's serum sample, and confirmatory test detect either P24 antigen or viral culture, or detect the HIV RNA or HIV DNA. And in non-specific tests, we can look for the CD4 T cell count, or hypergamma globulinemia, or altered CD4 to CD8 T cell ratio. So these are the non-specific tests which help us in the determination of the prognosis of the patient's condition. So antibody detection can be done by screening assays. Screening assays usually take less time, 2 to 3 hours for ELISA, and even less, like only 30 minutes for rapid or simple tests. These tests should be having high sensitivity. They must detect all positive sera, even if some false positive results may occur. So these tests are more concerned about the true positives rather than the true negatives. But all these assays should be confirmed. Whenever the positive result is there, these should be reconfirmed by other tests. Rapid or simple tests are developed for ease of performance and quick results, for saving the time. The most commonly used rapid or simple tests are dot blot assay, also known as immunoconcentration or flow through method. The most common name you must have heard is tri dot test for HIV. Second is immunochromatography, abbreviated as ICT, or lateral flow assay, that is rapid cart based test. Third is particle agglutination assays using different particles like latex, gelatin or RBCs. And fourth is dipstick or comb tests, which are ELISA based assays. Supplemental tests, which are the highly specific antibody detection methods used for validation of positive results of screening tests. These are expensive, labor intensive, need expertise to interpret, and may also give unequivocal or indeterminate results. Most commonly used test among the supplemental tests is Western blot, which is also recommended by NACO. Second supplemental test is detection of P24 core antigen. P24 antigen becomes detectable after 1 to 2 weeks of infection. So very early phase of the infection, P24 antigen can be detected. The uses of P24 antigen detection tests are for confirmation of diagnosis of HIV and AIDS, diagnosis of HIV during window period. What window period is, that we will see later on. To diagnose late stage of HIV or AIDS or CNS disease, diagnosis of HIV in infants, but this test is not that much reliable, monitoring the progress of HIV infection, and to resolve equivocal Western blot results. And lastly, the PCR based methods, detection of either viral RNA or viral DNA. These methods are called as gold standard for diagnosis of HIV infection. Various formats are available, such as RT-PCR, branched DNA assay, and nucleic acid sequence based amplification assays. These tests are most sensitive and specific. They detect even few copies of viral RNA and called as the best method for confirmation of HIV. PCR is useful for diagnosis of pediatric HIV also, and to differentiate latent HIV infection from active viral transcription. This is the best tool for diagnosis of HIV during window period as well, because it detects HIV earlier than all available methods. These tests can also be used for viral load monitoring, that is determining the severity or degree of the infection, and also for detection of drug resistant genes, and antiviral drugs are used in the treatment. Many of the patients may not respond to the treatment. So in such cases, we can go for the detection of drug resistance genes in such patients. Isolation of the virus, that is culture of the virus in vitro. As you already know, viruses do not replicate outside a host cell. They require a living culture medium such as egg inoculation or animal inoculation or cell culture or tissue culture. In case of HIV, such isolation is very difficult because it is time consuming, expensive and takes longer time, more than 6 weeks, and it is also not sensitive. So isolation method or culture method is very rarely used in case of HIV, and it is used only at the research facilities level. Now the non-specific or immunological tests, CD4 T cell count is one of the tests. Measurement of CD4 T cell count is carried out by flow cytometry, and it is useful in assessing the risk of opportunistic infections. Depending on the number of CD4 T cells, we can decide whether the patient is at the risk of getting opportunistic infections. Also, the initiation of antiviral therapy can be decided if CD4 T cell count falls below 350 per cubic millimeter. And this test also helps in monitoring the response to antiviral therapy. Now some description of NACO strategies for HIV diagnosis. NACO has formulated a strategic plan for HIV diagnosis depending on different situations or conditions. There are three different strategies, strategy 1, 2 and 3, where strategy 2 is subdivided into A and B. In all the three strategies, if first test becomes negative, the result is declared as negative. But depending on different strategies, additional one or two more tests are performed only when the first test result is positive. If the first test result is negative, the result is directly declared as negative. So strategy or algorithm 1 is for transfusion or transplantation safety, or simply known as donor safety. Here only one test is performed, and depending on the one test, the result is declared. If positive, result is declared as positive, no further test. In strategy 2A, it is done for surveillance. Two tests are performed. The second test is performed only if the result of first test is positive. In strategy 2B, which is for diagnosis of an individual with AIDS indicated disease, there is a long list of AIDS indicated disease, or when clinicians suspect that this person might be suffering from AIDS. In this case, three different tests are performed. If the first test result is positive, further tests are performed. Same is the case for strategy 3, to detect HIV infection in asymptomatic individuals. Here, strategy is a little bit different. Still, if the first test result is negative, it is declared as negative, and further tests are done only if the first test result is positive. Now, some aspects of diagnosis of pediatric HIV, that is HIV infection in the newborns or the pediatric patients. The recommended methods for diagnosis of pediatric HIV include HIV DNA detection, which is the most recommended method, or HIV RNA detection, or P24 antigen detection, or IgG ELISA, which can be done only after 18 months of age. As you all know, antibodies that are transferred from mother to the baby can be detected in the pediatric patient's serum sample. So sometimes we may get a false positive results also. To confirm that results, antibody detection tests are done only after 18 months of age. Now, diagnosis of HIV in window period. What is the definition of window period? Window period refers to the initial time interval between the exposure and appearance of detectable levels of antibodies in the serum. This definition is slightly different from the definition of incubation period. Do not confuse between incubation period and window period. So window period is related to the level of antibodies in blood, and incubation period is related to the appearance of clinical symptoms. The antibodies, so in case of HIV, the window period is relatable. The antibodies appear in blood within 2 to 8 weeks after infection, but usually become detectable after 3 weeks to 12 weeks with the assays available presently. So different assays which can be done for diagnosis of HIV in window period are P24 antigen detection or HIV RNA detection, that is PCR based, polymerase chain reaction based method, which is the best method which can detect the HIV infection at the earliest, even by 12th day of the infection. Now some aspects about treatment of HIV infection, which is called as antiretroviral therapy, ART. These antiviral drugs which are administered to the HIV infected individuals are not able to kill all the viruses or not able to cure the disease of the patient. However, they have the following goals. These antiviral drugs are administered to the patients with following goals, which are subdivided into clinical goals. Clinical goals can be prolongation of life, improvement in quality of life, and stopping the progression of the HIV disease. The virological goals can be greatest possible reduction in the viral load for as long as possible, and immunological goals can be immune reconstitution, both quantitative and qualitative. So for repairing the immunity of the patient. So these are the goals considering which the antiretroviral therapy is administered to the patients. These are the examples of antiretroviral drugs or anti-HIV drugs. Namely, three categories are there: nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors or NRTI. Examples of these are zidovudine, stavudine, and lamivudine. Second category is non-nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors or non-NRTI. Examples are nevirapine, efavirenz. And third category is protease inhibitors, nelfinavir and ritonavir. The NACO, the organization, has given us the guidelines for usage of different combinations of these three category drugs. The name of the regimen that is administered to the patients is called as highly active antiretroviral therapy or HAART, HART. So under HART, different combinations of the three categories of antiretroviral drugs are used. In addition to these drugs, when opportunistic infections are there, these should be adequately treated with appropriate antimicrobial agents. Most commonly used is clotrimoxazole prophylaxis for prevention of pneumocystis pneumonia. When ART or HART regimen is started, it has to be monitored whether the patient is responding to the treatment or not. The monitoring can be done by various ways or various assays, such as CD4 T cell count, which is the most commonly used method, or HIV RNA load, that is what is the viral load in the patient undergoing treatment, or P24 antigen detection, and some other methods. Now some aspects about post-exposure prophylaxis or PEP. PEP is required to reduce the risk of transmission after occupational exposures such as needle stick or sharp injury or mucocutaneous exposure. As you all know, HIV is the most dreaded infection in occupational exposures. So every hospital should have a nodal center for PEP management and must provide PEP free of cost to all the employees whenever such incidences happen. PEP should be started within 2 hours of exposure if the source is unknown or a known positive case of HIV. The regimen which may contain single daily dose of tenofovir, and additional drugs can be added like lamivudine or efavirenz, and is given for 28 days. Now some aspects of NACO guidelines to prevent neonatal HIV. As you know, HIV can be transferred from the placental barrier. There are only few bacteria or viral infections or parasitic infections which can get transmitted from the placental barrier from the infected mother to the fetus in utero. So NACO has given the guidelines to prevent neonatal HIV infection. In this, the newborn baby is given 6 weeks of syrup nevirapine immediately after birth. The dosage can be extended up to 12 weeks. So syrup nevirapine is administered to the baby. Baby is also initiated on cotrimoxazole prophylaxis at 6 weeks till 18 months. So this is for prevention of neonatal HIV. And remember, this prophylactic measure is very helpful and it prevents the infection in the newborn baby who is born to an infected HIV infected mother. Now some aspects about HIV vaccine strategies. You must be knowing, developing a vaccine for HIV infection has not been possible yet, but still research is going on. What are the reasons for this difficulty in developing a vaccine for HIV? The reasons being high mutability of the virus, which is the single most important factor. Along with that, long latent period between exposure and appearance of symptoms, and lack of ideal small animal models for vaccine trials. Various experimental animals are used, but HIV doesn't actually infect or cause active disease in most of the animals, and HIV is problematic only in human beings. So there is lack of ideal small animal models. Also, there are ethical issues because difficulty to get human volunteers for HIV vaccine trial. So these are the hurdles in developing a vaccine for HIV infections. Still, these are some of the approaches and trials going on all over the world for developing a vaccine against HIV infections, like SAV001, RV144 and some other. So that is all about all the aspects of HIV infection, morphology, laboratory diagnosis, treatment and preventive measures for HIV infection. As you all know, prevention is always better than cure. The same is true for the current COVID-19 pandemic, and same is true for all other infections. Thank you.
Stephen,
come.